Hello and welcome everyone. Thank you very much for taking the time and joining us today for our webinar. We are really excited to have you all here on the panel, and yeah, hope it's a nice distraction from your usual like lockdown routine, and hopefully you will take away some insights from the presentation today. So we want to speak with you today about AI created content. So what is artificial intelligence? What are the benefits of it? What are the drawbacks? And also how do machines actually generate content? And as you know, content is used across all kinds of different channels, but it's definitely a very important part of SEO as well. So we have to ask ourselves the question, what is Google's viewpoint on AI created content? And for this webinar, we actually came up with a really interesting study. So we chose three existing content pieces and signed up for a bunch of AI tools we found on the internet and let them recreate these existing content pieces. And with the help of a scorecard, we were able to score and measure and compare them to the existing content pieces. And yeah, that's what we want to show you today, what we found out with that, which we're really excited to do so. And then at the end of the presentation, we're really keen to hear your questions on the topic, your thoughts. So please use the chat box at the end, and really, yeah, hoping we get some questions going and we try to answer them as good as possible. To introduce us as the speakers today quickly, so my name is Katie. I'm an SEO account director at 3PipeReply.
Hi everyone, I'm Alex. I'm an SEO operations manager at 3PipeReply as well.
So we are a brand performance agency. We offer a lot of different digital services, so anything from paid media to PR, design, Amazon, and of course SEO, and we really cover like any parts of it from technical, e-commerce, on-page content. And as you can see, we work for a large amount of clients in all kinds of different verticals, from retail, travel, technology, sports, and really all kinds of different sizes. So our opening question for this webinar to come up with the study and this whole topic was really, can AI replace human content writers? And I'm sure this is a question you've asked yourself before as well, and probably why you're interested in this webinar and actually signed up for it. And even though it looks like a question that can be like easily answered as a yes or no question, it's not that easy. And there is a lot of like debate around AI. So there are a lot of like positive and negative things about it. I mean, with the obvious benefits, it's a huge time saver. So if you think about it, it takes a human around 3 hours to write a piece of content, whereas for a machine, it spits out the piece within like a minute. So it saves you a lot of time, a lot of resource, and with this, of course, a lot of money that you then be able to invest into other parts of the business. So that's really attractive for a lot of companies. It also gives you the option to scale. So when we speak to a lot of our clients, there's a lot of the times a limitation in terms of how much content can be created within a month. But with like a tool, you will be able to significantly increase the amount of content that can be produced. And then also it's fair to say that tools can much more accurately analyze and process a huge set of data than humans can with much less errors. But on the other hand, we also have some like critical voices. So there's this like evergreen argument that machines will take over our jobs eventually. So in that case for content writers, but what we mean with like ethically controversial here is more when you think about topics like what's the best running shoe or how to overcome emotional eating. So these are like more topics that you need to have experience for. Like a machine never like ate food or a random marathon. So it's kind of strange to read that from something that has never experienced it before, and like it loses the human touch completely. And then another argument that often pops up is that AI can be biased. So if, because the AI creates content based on a large set of data, and if that data uses stereotypes or is opinionated, then of course the outcome will be opinionated as well. And there's limited control over that, and a lot of examples actually where this is the case. And of course, we also have to think about Google, right? So well, if you think about if anyone in the world is able to create endless amount of content, that will clog up the crawling and indexing process of Google completely. So like, and it's also against Google guidelines. So it's fair to say that Google will probably adapt or update like their measurements more and more towards that as well, especially when we look at the previous Google algorithm updates that were like specifically focused on content. So as you can see here, it started off more with like quantity metrics, so avoiding like thin content, duplicate content, you might get penalized for like keyword like stuffing. And then like over time it got more and more like sophisticated, especially with the introduction of like RankBrain and BERT more recently, that like relevancy and context became like much more important. And yeah, as I said, we are pretty certain that like Google will take more of these like quality like measurements like into consideration in the future. It's kind of ironic though, because Google uses a machine or AI as well in order to assess and rank the content. So like we have to ask ourselves at the end of the day, will it be a better machine against a machine when it comes to content writing? So yeah, I guess we will see about this. For now, we actually would really like to do a quiz with you. So we actually came up with three content examples. And we would like to hear from you if you think it was created by AI or if it was created by a human. So we will show you the examples. Please don't like overthink. So just go ahead with what you think could be the answer. And we have this lovely poll function here on Zoom. So you can just put in the answer what you think is correct. So looking at the first example is actually an earthquake report. It goes as follows. A shallow magnitude 4.7 earthquake was reported Monday morning, 5 miles from Westwood, California, according to the US Geological Survey. The tremor occurred at 6:25 a.m. Pacific time at a depth of 5 miles. So I think now you should see the poll coming up. If you could, yeah, vote for what you think is the correct answer. So it's just the first question for now. So we go to the second and the third one in a second. So giving you like 5 more seconds to decide on that, what you think is correct. Okay. And then we're going to move on to the next example. So you can just minimize the poll on your screen as well to be able to see the next one. So the next one is from a book. It goes as follows. Kitty couldn't fall asleep for a long time. Her nerves were strained as 2 tight strings. And even a glass of hot wine that Vronsky made her drink did not help. Lying in bed, she kept going over and over that monstrous scene at the meadow. So again, if you could go back to the poll and then to the second question and let us know your thoughts. If you think that was created by an AI or a human. Cool, and then we go to the very last example. It's actually a poem, so it's you are inscribed in the lines on the ceiling, you are inscribed in the depths of the storm. So again, if you can go quickly to the poll and let us know what your opinion is on that. If you can bring up the presentation.
Sure.
Okay, so I see like quite a few people have voted already. Let's have a look at the results. Okay, I hope you can all see it. So looking at the first questions, most of you thought this was written by AI. With the second question, it's like pretty much a few more people thought it's written by a human. And again, with the poem, it's also a bit of a mixed bag. Okay, thank you very much for joining our little quiz here. Basically, we tried to fool you a little bit. So all of these examples were actually written by AI. We tried to surprise you and to show you how similar some of these examples can be to what humans write, and it's actually quite hard to distinguish. But to also put that into perspective, all of these 3 examples were taken from projects where like millions went into the funding and a lot of like research like happened to create these projects. So with our study, we look more into like widely accessible tools that you can find on the internet. Before we go into the study, we actually want to quickly explain a couple of terms. I appreciate that we around some of these already, and I'm sure you read these on the internet or in the news already. So just to really clarify what the difference between these are. And starting off with artificial intelligence. So this is a term that has been around probably the longest. It started popping up in the 60s. And it basically means to incorporate human intelligence into machines. To mimic our actions. So a machine completes a task based on a certain number of rules. Whereas with like machine learning, the machine gains actually the ability to improve and learn by itself based on the data it was given. And then we have like deep learning, which is the next step of machine learning, and it's a bit of more of a recent term, and it is basically inspired by the human brain. It tries to copy the information processing patterns of our brains. So now we try to teach machines language. And language is something that is natural for humans. Like every human communicates. Even if you're deaf, you will start to learn like sign language and communicate that way. So for humans, it's very natural, but for machines, it is not. So and due to the complexity of language, it's a pretty challenging task. So scientists use something called natural language processing in order to do so. And we want to look into that in a little bit more detail because it's really interesting. So natural language processing consists of two main components. So on the one hand side, we have natural language generation, which basically is anything around knowing all the words that are in the dictionary, how to spell them, the rules of grammar, syntax, so how to structure a sentence properly, and then being able to create a piece of text with that knowledge. The other part is natural language understanding, which is much more complex because you don't really have a set number of rules for that. And it's something when you think about there are words that have various meanings. So for example, the word fan or the word nail. So you have the fingernail or you have like a nail that you put into the wall. Or when you think about a sentence like, call me a cab. So out of context, you would probably know if it's the end of the night and I want to get home, that I would like you to call me a driver to get me back to my house. But the question is, how does a machine learn this context? And I want to give you like one more really nice example from Noam Chomsky. He is one of the most famous linguists in the world, and he basically studied language and the structure his whole entire life. And he created this sentence, colorless screen, ideas sleep furiously. And this is a grammatically correct sentence, but we all know like it's nonsense. It doesn't make any sense. The question here is, though, will machines be able to understand that this doesn't make any sense? Because from the rules they've learned, it's a correct sentence. So I think that was something we were really interested to see in our study. How far are we in the process? And machines really understand what is like the content about? So over to Alex now, who is talking you through the study and our findings.
Cheers. Yeah, so kind of moving on to our study. So with all the kind of hype and interest around AI in not only SEO, but just the wider marketing kind of landscape in the last few years, we wanted to see and carry out a study to find out whether we could leverage the technology to specifically in terms of creating content and whether it could be useful in terms of generating more content and producing kind of well-optimized content from an SEO perspective. So the first thing we had to do kind of was find what was available to us. So we did some research online and found some, and as Katie mentioned earlier, we wanted to find like widely accessible tools, not kind of a multi-million pound AI, but something that's accessible to the majority of brands and agencies to help with their kind of SEO effort. So we found some popular kind of widely accessible tools, which kind of fell into two brackets. So the first two, Article Forge and Articulo, basically work by you input a keyword or a topic or a set of keywords and topics, select the length of your article, then the AI works its magic. And by magic, we mean it analyzes its data set around these kind of keywords and topics and then produces a finished article. And then the second or third tool, fell into the second set, which is a more kind of traditional article spinner. So it basically analyzes an article that you input, again, works its magic and rewrites it, and then produces a unique piece based off the article that you kind of input. So once we had the kind of tools, we wanted to test them to their full capacity. And to do that, we looked into creating articles for three different industries, basically to just see where different levels of difficulty and types of content came into play. So just to take you through the three industries we looked at initially, so pharma was the first one. So we picked this one because it's quite high level of difficulty in terms of content, and it, as a highly regulated field in the UK at least, the accuracy and the contents and information included in articles in this field need to be to the kind of highest level. The second industry we looked at was fashion. So generally in the fashion industry, articles published, whether it's by a publication or a brand, are a reflection of that kind of brand's tone of voice. So basically reflects what the company stands for and is therefore subjective. So we wanted to see how AI fared in terms of creating articles that are more subjective, let's say. And then the third industry we looked at was sports, because it's a lot easier comparatively to pharma and fashion in terms of content and writing the content. So once we had the three kind of industries, we need to decide what topics to cover within these industries. So with the pharma one, we decided to write an article about nothing kind of too obscure. So just a general, quite common article around ibuprofen and its uses for adults. And for the human-generated content that we wanted to compare it to, as the kind of lead and most authoritative figure in the UK around the subject, we used this NHS article by the same name to compare the AI content to. For fashion, on the other hand, we went with, in terms of topic, an SEO classic from the How to Wear series. So anyone that works in SEO will be very familiar with kind of what to wear, how to wear. And for comparison, we went with this John Lewis article from their editor on how to dress for a Christmas party. And finally, for sports, we looked at, in terms of topic, the comparison between rugby league and rugby union and what the differences are between the sports. And for the human content, we went with one of our clients, Keith Prowse. So once we had all the content, so the human and AI generated content, we then had to score the content. And just to take a step back here, we would have loved to have published these articles online and see how they fared in terms of organic visibility and consequently traffic. But from an SEO perspective, there were just too many variables to consider to be able to publish these online. So for example, the domain authority on which the articles are published would have to be the same. And the NHS is probably the most authoritative, apart from probably Wikipedia, out there. So it would have been, there were just too many variables to do an accurate like-for-like comparison online. So basically, we came up with a kind of scoring system ourselves and asked for a number of colleagues that work in a variety of different disciplines, not just SEO, to just kind of create a fairer score for the articles, to rate the content, both the AI and human-generated content. And to ensure that everyone kind of rated the content in the same way and followed the same kind of guidelines, we came up with a scoring system that kind of took into account a variety of not only SEO factors, but also writing kind of techniques and factors to then be able to kind of analyze and predict how the articles would have behaved if they were to have been published online and see how they fared in terms of organic visibility. So for the first metric we looked at, an SEO classic, obviously, keywords. So did the articles use correct keywords? Were they over kind of used, were they stuffed, or were they not used enough? The second metric we looked at was more around the technique. So how was the article written? Was it grammatically correct? Was the spelling correct? Was it punctuated in the right way? And was it easily readable? Because obviously no one wants to read an article that's complete gibberish. And if it were complete gibberish, it'd likely not rank well in search results either. The third area we looked at again was kind of an SEO cornerstone. So article structure and how was the content kind of structured? Was it structured in a logical way in terms of paragraphs? Were the headlines optimized? Did it have headlines? And were there subheadings? Because obviously if an article is structured well and you have optimized headlines, you're more likely to rank for kind of feature snippets. And then the fourth metric we looked at, which was kind of the most important one to us, was really the contents of the actual article. So what information was included in these articles? Was it accurate? Did it include external sources? And if it included external sources, were these sources authoritative? were the articles neutrally written? Kind of, did they include duplication? Were they kind of duplicates of other articles online, and so on? And then the final metric we looked at was more around kind of tone of voice. So as we've mentioned earlier, for fashion specifically, but just generally, articles are a reflection of the brand. So how did this kind of AI generated content fare in terms of tone of voice? Did it have a tone of voice, or was this kind of just taken from somewhere else? So all the elements were scored from a rate of 0 to 4 and all weighted equally. Right, the results then of the study. So once we kind of scored all the content and all our colleagues scored the content, we took all these kind of scores and averaged out to get the final results for each of the articles in each of the different industries. So starting with the pharma results. So that's what the three kind of tools scored. So it wasn't horrendous, but it wasn't great either. The thing we found interesting here was that the articles that the tools where you input the keyword or the topic created scored significantly higher than the ones created by the article screener. And just for comparison, the NHS article scored 99%. As you can imagine, it couldn't have scored much higher, really. And the area that we really focused on for the pharma articles was content. So how accurate was the information included in the content? Was it misleading? Because as you can imagine, in the pharmaceutical industry, not only are you liable to being sued if you give out the wrong information around what medicine people should take, but obviously it can result in quite dire consequences if the guidelines aren't followed, let's say. So at this stage, we would have loved to have shown you the full article so you could kind of get an idea of what was included, but for time purposes, obviously we can share the entire thing. So we just took a few snippets here. And like we said, there were some positives. So for example, for the pharma articles, it did have some quite good information, like to follow the directions on the medicine, to consult the doctor if you were having an allergic reaction, and then the bonus one at the end, which is slightly related, but it was a good thing to pee longer than normal whenever you drink more water, which is quite good advice. Then on the other side of things, there was some kind of information that wasn't quite correct that could have been result in not so good consequences, let's say, if it was followed. So for example, the top quote there, that it's safe to take aspirin. So not only was it talking about the wrong medicine in the article, but also then followed by saying can be taken with ibuprofen and even codeine. And we're not doctors, but I mean, general advice is not to mix kind of medicines. And we did some research and aspirin is not supposed to be mixed with codeine. And then the following sentence was to not take aspirin with aspirin. So it was duplication as well. And again, in the second sentence, it's difficult on both the liver and the liver. So this is not the kind of quality level content that you would expect from something as important as the pharmaceutical industry. So it's not something the NHS could have published on the site once it had been generated by the tools. Then moving on to the fashion results. So the fashion results surprisingly actually scored lower than the pharma results. And again, the kind of the ones that were based, the articles that were produced by off the back of keywords and topics scored higher than the article spinning content. And again, for comparison, the John Lewis article scored 82%, so significantly higher than the AI generated content. And then in terms of the kind of metric that we focused on here, it was more around tone of voice. So how subjective are the articles? And like we'll see in the snippets in the next slide, the articles tried to be subjective, but kind of failed for, again, a reason that we'll cover in the next slide. So really here, this is not the type of content produced that you would want to kind of publish on your site without having significantly edited it beforehand. And then again, showing you a few snippets from this. So there were some good things in the articles. So for example, the top quote there saying to enjoy yourself and take pride in your appearance, which is always a good piece of advice. And then the bottom quote, if I've been overdoing it with mince pies by default, is slick black pants. So this is quite a strange sentence to read, knowing that a machine or AI had generated this content, because obviously a machine doesn't eat mince pies or wear slick black pants, unless it's changed in the last kind of couple of hours. So obviously here it was trying to be subjective, but as we can see from the example at the top right there, the reason it was trying to be subjective is because it had just pulled in content and paragraphs from other articles So for example, the top one there, Fashion Even is a platform where you'll get help, particularly when you're attempting to be familiar with the creative thoughts about black tie and red bow. So you can see that the subjectivity had come from this other article that was produced by Fashion Even, which is a publication that covers the latest fashion trends. So that's where the subjectivity of the AI came from, not independently. And then the bottom quote, again, this is a type of, there were some good kind of article structures and readability in certain parts, but then, like you can see from the bottom sentence there, the best way to pull this off is to have the red hat and gloves on the side of your head and wear the hat over your eyes. So, I mean, you can't really tell, but I'm not really a fashion expert, but I definitely wouldn't wear gloves on the side of my head and wear a red hat over my eyes at a dinner party for Christmas. So it's not really great fashion advice. And if you were reading that as a person, you'd think that there's something a little bit off there. So having gone through the fashion ones, moving on to the sport. Unsurprisingly here, the sport article scored significantly higher than the other two, largely due to the level of kind of difficulty involved in creating these articles. And again, surprisingly here, the article spinner scored a lot higher than it did in the other kind of two instances. But again, for the third time, the human kind of generated content by Keith Prowse scored 93%, which was significantly higher than the AI generated content. And in terms of the metric that we've focused on here, it was more about structure. So because of the topic that we were covering, so the differences between rugby league and rugby union, it can be quite a confusing topic to cover unless the article is structured in an appropriate way where you're covering the different sections and it's easy to read. And again, here it kind of didn't perform as well as it could have. Let's say the sections were jumbled up and it was just difficult to read, and you generally didn't get a good idea of what the differences were between the sports having read that article. As with the first two industries, we'll show you a couple of snippets here. So there were some good things, again, a call to action there at the top, saying that if you're thinking about joining a team, you want to analyse the kind of differences between rugby union and rugby league before you join a team, which is quite good advice. And then at the bottom, it correctly indicated the number of players in each sport, so 13 and 15 for rugby league and rugby union, respectively. But then there were also some negatives in the article. So, for example, the top quote there, taken from one of the AI-generated content pieces, is saying that the All Blacks played at the Rugby World Cup for the first time in 2020. And so if you know anything about rugby, you'll know that not only did the All Blacks not play at the Rugby World Cup for the first time in 2020, they in fact won the first World Cup, that was in 1987. So that's highly inaccurate kind of content. And then the bottom quote was referencing, so the articles were published for the UK market, and here it's referencing National Rugby League, which is the governing body of the sport in Australia. So if you were to have published that article, you would be referencing the wrong kind of governing body and therefore the wrong inaccurate information for the market. So kind of to sum up the research, there were some good areas. So for example, keywords and technique, there was generally relatively good use of keywords in the articles, and they weren't overly staffed or too few generally. And again, in terms of technique, this was the most positive area or metric that we looked at. So there was good spelling, punctuation, and grammar kind of across all the different AI generated content. Then kind of moving on to not so positive things. So structure, the articles were generally a mixed match of, from what we could see, other articles that it pulled from the data set, the tools it pulled from the data set. So in terms of structure, they weren't really laid out in a coherent way, and it was just more often than not gibberish. The content, again, like we went through some examples for each of the different industries, it included at times incorrect information. And again, this might tie into the because it pulled kind of content from other articles and it mixed all this information together to generate a new piece that, based on pieces that were originally accurate, are now not accurate anymore. And then from a kind of tone of voice perspective, as we predicted at the beginning, the way these articles work is based on data sets from kind of other articles and just generally the data sets that the tools have used to create them. So they can't be subjective, they can't really have a tone of voice unless this is based on existing tone of voice from other articles, so not unique tone of voice. But kind of concluding and going back to the initial sentence and the initial question that led to this study, can AI generated content replace human writers? So in our kind of based at the back of our study, the short answer to that question is not at the moment. But obviously it's never that kind of easy. It's not a yes or no question. So if you were to use these tools, for example, we use them for full-blown articles, so 1,000 pieces or longer. But if you, in smaller snippets and smaller paragraphs, they can be used. So if you, from an SEO perspective, if you wanted to use them for kind of product descriptions, for example, or landing page intro copy, they could be quite useful with a little bit of editing here and there, obviously, to make sure that everything's correct. They can be used for that. But like we said, when it comes to full-blown kind of longer tail articles, they're not quite there yet. But having said that, the potential of the technology is clear, and it's made massive strides in the last 2 years. And with the rate at which it's progressing, we definitely see this progressing further, obviously, in the next couple of years. And from our perspective, this is something we will keep an eye on in the next couple of years. And when it gets to that stage where, which it surely will, where it can almost mimic a human's writing, it's definitely something we'll consider leveraging to kind of improve our SEO offering and content production. So that's all for us. Thank you for listening, especially to me rambling on for the last kind of 20 minutes.